Good evening.
There we go.
Okay, thank you. In this talk, I will present you a mission concept called metric. Okay, metric is an acronym for measurement of environmental and relativistic in-orbit perceptions, and it focuses on three apparently completely different, but in reality intertwined, scientific objective. The first one, map atmospheric density by in-situ direct acceleration measurement, together with SLR and GNSS tracking. The second is having refined tests of gravitation theories, having at disposal a practically gravitational test mass. And the third, provide a particular space-based co-location site. So, the initial ideas we had some years ago is, okay, let us consider a satellite with a high sensitivity accelerometer, which is in fact is developed in my research group. With such an instrument, we could try to measure the atmospheric density in roughly 450 and 1200 kilometer altitude by putting this satellite in a polar or quasi-polar and very eccentric orbit. Okay, knowledge of atmospheric density in this altitude range is still affected by large uncertainties. And improved knowledge of this density will benefit a lot of several things, in particular satellite lifetimes and accuracy of conjunction assessment. Okay, at this point we say, okay, we have in any case to track this satellite in order to a posteriori reconstruct the local density measurement. We could do some interesting test of gravitational physics. A satellite as such with an accelerometer could be considered as an a posteriori sort of drag-free satellites. And so a gravitational test mass in which the role of the non-gravitational perturbation is practically taken out from the acceleration measurement. And so with this type of hypothesized orbit, we could test the equation of motion of a massive body in a given gravitational field. And so we could provide, in principle, a different and complementary, with respect to the presentation we have seen above, test of general relativity. In this slide, you can see the PPN low slow motion version of the equation of motion, in which it has been underlined the three main contributions from general relativity: gravimagnetic, lens steering, and the fitter. And if you do some back of the envelope calculation, we get some interesting numbers compared, for example, with Lagos. The advantages, in fact, are very apparent. A very elongated orbit makes possible a very precise measurement of the precession of the epicenter axis, and having a polar or quasi-polar strongly suppresses the competing Newtonian non-gravitational signal, especially the even zonal harmonics, as we have seen in previous presentation. So at this point we say, okay, we want to track this satellite with at least satellite laser ranging and GNSS. And okay, we know that there is a third problem that it is well known to this audience. SLR and VLBI are critical, we know, for the ATRF frame definition. And there are some very well established reasons why it is important to having a space-based core collocation site, so a satellite which could be tracked at the same time by at least two, three, ideally four space physics. This idea is not new, in fact. There have been at least two past proposals from the United States called GRASP and IGRASP, but unfortunately have been not carried away. And now there is a currently proposal by the Genesis program by European Space Agency. I will say something later. So, this is the basic mission idea. This is a mission concept, so you will see a lot of TDB. The idea is having a very small compact satellite, think about a LEGOs, but active LEGOs, not passive, with three-axis accelerometer for measurement of non-gravitational perturbation, laser letter effectors for tracking by SLR, a GNSS receiver, and also a vacuum pressure light gauge that would help in doing the atmospheric density measurement. The strategy is having a polar eccentric orbit, roughly 450 times 1200 kilometers, track, as said, with at least two space geodesy techniques, virtual drag-free, a posteriori drag-free by using the onboard accelerometer, modulate the acceleration signal by having this spacecraft slowly spinning, on typically a spinning direction orthogonal to the orbital plane, in this way achieve a separation of atmospheric drag and solar radiation pressure signals. Indeed, depending on the experiment we want to achieve, measurement of acceleration of, or measurement of relativistic effects, what is a noise for an experiment becomes the signal for the other experiment. And indeed, we made some preliminary estimation that we are confident that thanks to the chosen geometry, we would have been able rather well to separate the effect due to drag to the effect due to solar radiation pressure. Accelerometer, we based our initial analysis of AISA, Italian Spin Accelerometer, which is the accelerometer we are developing in our research group. This is a three-axis accelerometer. You can see here in the photo the flight version that is now flying on Bepi Colombo mission to planet Mercury. An identical version called HAA will fly on board JUICE mission to Jupiter. And these are the main features of the for metric, and this is the feature of the current developed accelerometer. For metric, consider we would like to have an accelerometer a couple of order of magnitude more sensitive than the AISA as presently done in Bepi Colombo. And this is considered achievable relying on ongoing development activities in our group. Laser retroreflectors, this is a preliminary estimate done by the colleagues of INFN, Simone Dell'Agnello. The idea is having a retroreflector array distributed as homogeneous and isotropic as possible. Think about a sort of lasers, but cover only a fraction of the surface by retroreflectors. And a preliminary target SLR accuracy, it's okay. Feasible 1 centimeter or better. We saw also, but it's just nice to have, further options, having on board on atomic clock, sorry, of course, not a hydrogen maser, but a simple clock in which we could perform a dedicated redshift experiment thanks to the very elliptic orbit. And especially, it would be very interesting, but not trivial at all, having on board a VLBI beacon. But this is something not trivial, especially considering that the orbit is rather low and eccentric. Preliminary estimates, we would like to have, as I said, very compact satellite, sort of LEGO-like dimension, with very low power consumption, and weighing from 100 to 200 kilograms. And this is very important, the mission duration would cover at least one solar cycle in order to explore the dependency of atmospheric density on the solar activity. And TRL preliminary estimates are encouraging, apart of course the spacecraft that is only at conceptual level. We gathered a lot of colleagues in Italy. This has to be considered first approximation in Italian mission. There is a lot of expertise in Italy in these various fields. I want to say some more regarding the overlap. As perhaps you are aware, there is an ESA program called Genesis, which has the objective of gathering all four space geodesic techniques in a single satellite. So you may say, okay, you are just replying Genesis mission, not. The orbit is different, lower and eccentric. The mission duration is different, much longer, and we have also other science objects. So the potential overlapping with this European Space Agency program are small. One thing to be very, very important, you can also ask, okay, but there are also other missions which has SLR and GSS. It is not a novelty, you're right. But as experience in constructing the ITRF says that the importance of the precision in establishing the ties. Current ties between the various space geodesic techniques are on ground, of course. And the tie with the between the various techniques on space should be very, very high precision. So the idea is having a very compact, meteorologically well-calibrated platform. This should be something that we should be very, very careful of it. And so, conclusion, this is just an idea we are working about and also searching for potential financing funds in Italy. The idea is having a LAGOS-like satellite, but active, not passive, and centered around this accelerometer with accurate tracking by at least two space geodesic techniques. The polar eccentric orbit has the advantage of enabling, in principle, very precise relativistic measurement. You have heard in the previous presentation that one of the problems of all the measurements, for example, of the lens steering effect, is the impact of the zonal harmonics. Well, if you take the equation, you see that ideally, with a polar orbit, these effects cancel, or at least are very strongly suppressed. This is not a new idea. It was proposed in the 1970s by Van Patten and Everett. So this is a very, very good orbit, we think. And thanks to the accelerometer, we would like to get rid of the problem of the non-gravitational perturbation. At the same time, we think that we could give a valuable contribution also to the geodesy by helping tying together the various space geodesic techniques. Some references, and that's all.
Thank you. Do we have questions? Yeah, Tom.
For such a mission, is it not more desirable to have a MESA on board rather than a CC?
Sorry, yeah?
MESA on board than a CC?
Yes, of course, but you know, if you want to do a complete space geodesy and also fundamental physics, we would like to have, but you know, a MESA is a very delicate object. So it's just a trade-off between money, stability of the platform, calibration issues, and so on. But in theory, why not? Yes.
Concerning the Genesis mission, the latest decision was to put it into the circular orbits, not to eccentric orbits. So the altitude would be at the height of about 6,000 kilometers, and also the inclination would be almost 90 degrees.
Yes, as I said, the geodetic objective is one-third of this mission. And so we think that we could be complementary. Of course, having an so slow orbit is not the best. So we saw about a trade-off between the various scientific objectives, but think about that. As far as I know, the Genesis mission duration would be 1-2 years. Zuhair Al-Tamimi, at the Sofia meeting, underlined the need from the geodesy part to having as much as possible continuous observation regarding the tides. So also the duration of the mission is important, unless you have continuous Genesis mission, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on.
Okay, thank you very much.